Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy riven side which flow be of sin the double cure. Cleanse me from its guilt and power. Not the labors of my hands can fulfill thy law's demands. Could my zeal no respite know, could my tears forever flow, all for sin could not atone. Thou must save, and thou alone. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. Foul I to the fountain fly, wash me, Savior, or I die. While I draw this fleeting breath, when mine eyelids close in death, when I soar to worlds unknown, see thee on thy judgment throne. Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It has turned into a beautiful day out there.
It is.
And I even love it that it's a little chilly and windy. That's good. When I came in this morning, it was 62 in here. I turned on the heat for y'all, you know, because I just soon keep at 62, you know. So you're welcome. Remind all the young folks catechism today after service. I'll be with y'all. Where's Julie? Where will we be? Upstairs? Up? Okay. So on the left side, as you're going up, middle room. Thank you to all of our vets. We showed the video this morning again at your request. We have a lot of folks who served here, so thank you to all y'all for your service. Sunday school is still going on. Kat's doing her thing this morning in 1:16, 17, 18, so drop in on her if you've been doing that. Where's Norm? Is not here. Bev, where you must be doing Norm's thing. You're up.
Hey, Bev Metcalf on behalf of the Strategic Planning Committee. So I'm speaking for Norm, who is running out of town. I thought we were supposed to have the new survey in your bulletin today, but I see that you don't. So it is ready to go. I guess we'll be able to get it out next Sunday is the best we can do. It's ready to roll. The thing that I thought was interesting as we were going over the first survey as compared to the second survey is just processing that the first survey was really, okay, let's figure out who we are, what we do well, what do we think of ourselves. And the second survey is very much focused on forward thinking. Okay, now where do we go from here? So it's a very different survey. Some thinking, but not, it shouldn't be too time consuming. We had put December 1st to get it back, but now that we're off a week, we'll probably bump that a little bit. Very quickly, the survey results of the first one are very detailed in your weekly news, which would be on Facebook and in your email, right? Is that the way, two ways people get it? Yeah. So you might want to take a look at that if you really want the details. In a nutshell, people recognize that we have changed at FUSC with less programs, change to one service, some more isolation due to COVID, you know, all the things that COVID did to everybody, did to us. Question three, why do you come to First United? And that is also in a very detailed analysis on the weekly news. I would just refer you to that. Nothing was surprising in all of these. What are things First United does well, and what would you like us to see do that we're not doing right now? Basically, kind of to get back to what we were, more activities, more interactions, that kind of thing. Let's see. We did have a suggestion for an improvement, changes into the Sunday worship service, although those fell out. We had really very few people that mentioned that, but you had people that wanted more traditional, but then people that wanted less traditional. You know, so it really balanced out. And then most people didn't really mention it at all. So I think that was kind of a wash, in my opinion. But it certainly is something that we always need to look at because it's an important part of our place in the community here. Any questions? So the next survey, when we do get it out, please get it back as soon as possible because we really would like to get it back, get it tabulated, and have it able to be presented at the congregational meeting in December if we can. It was in the Uniter. Yes, I do remember it being there. You know, and it may be if you have a couple, only one of them turned it in, but we need everybody to turn it in. Everybody's got their own opinion. So, yeah, every single person in here could turn it in. That'd be great. Okay. To be able to actually fill it out online and submit it, I do not have the expertise to figure that out. I think that's a really great idea, and absolutely have thought of that before. I just don't have the know-how to do it, but if you can help us, we will do it. Okay, thank you.
And thank you to the Strategic Planning Committee. I know y'all are working hard at this. This has got to be the most difficult job there is ministry planning, strategic planning, whatever you want to call it, in a church, because you don't have the kind of concrete data that you have in the business world when you're trying to do this sort of thing. So your feedback is very, very, very important in this process. So please do give feedback. One of the things that did happen to us in COVID is we've lost about 30% of our worshiping community. Part of them are still online because whenever we post the video every week, we still get as much as 24 or more hits on the video, which means there's 30 or 40, 50 people who are viewing our worship on Sundays. So there's still folks out there who have not come back. So if you know of anybody like that, please encourage them to come. Let them know that we're all safe here and we haven't had any problems. We do our best to make sure everybody is healthy. So let them know. Let them know. Anything else this morning? Mike.
Yeah, I've got to go off the line for Bill
Call me. I'll take care of it. I do this sort of thing. No, please do call me. Yeah. My schedule is such that I can do these sorts of things. I might have to drop something, but he's more important. So. Got it. We can handle it.
Can you summarize what was just said? We couldn't hear it back here.
Ron Emberg fell about a week or so ago and broke his collarbone and several ribs, and he needs to get back to St. Joseph this coming Thursday. And Mike plans to take him, but sometimes his company calls him in on out of the blue. So he was asking for somebody to be on call, and I'm going to be it. So if you need let me just say this. If any of you ever need transportation or you need something, call me. Please call me. And if I can't, I'll find somebody. But call me, because my schedule is very flexible, and I don't mind helping with these sorts of things. So please call me. If I know you're in the hospital. That's the other thing. Let me know you're in the hospital, not after you leave the hospital. Anyway, but, you know, I might have a little connection to the Holy Spirit, but it's not solid, you know. I'm not clairvoyant, so anyway, enough chastisement. Let us begin this morning. Please arise. We gather this day. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Amen.
Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and our neighbors. We have ignored voices that call for justice. We have neglected actions that witness to your righteousness. We have spoken and acted in ways that disrupt your community. We truly repent of things we have done and left undone. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Restore our troubled spirits so that we may live in newness, follow the way of the Spirit, and build up the body of Christ. Amen. Rejoice and be glad. God hears the prayers of all who cry out and restores us to live through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Therefore, I declare to you the forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We open with My Lord, What a Morning.
My Lord, what a morning, oh my Lord.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Lord Jesus, you are mighty God and Prince of Peace. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the Son of God and Son of Mary. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are Word made flesh and splendor of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns the music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee. King through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of love, behold his hands and side, rich wounds yet visible above, in beauty glorified. No angels in the sky can sight, but downward bend their burning eyes at mystery so bright. Crown him the Lord of years, the potentate of time, creator of the rolling spheres, ineffably sublime. Shall not fail throughout eternity.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without you nothing is strong, nothing is holy. Embrace us with your mercy, that with you as our ruler and guide, we may live through what is temporary without losing what is eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for the readings.
Good morning.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right, thank you. The first reading is from Malachi chapter 4. Malachi, whose name means my messenger, warns that the day is coming. On that day, the evil will be destroyed like stubble in a fire, but the sun of righteousness will shine on those who honor God. See, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all the arrogant and all evildoers will be stubble. The day that comes shall burn them up, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. But if for you who revere my name, the Sun of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
We're going to read together Psalm 98. Sing a new song to the Lord. Who has done marvelous things? whose right hand and holy arm have won the victory. O Lord, you have made known your victory. You have revealed your righteousness in the sight of the nations. You remember your steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth shall have seen the victory of our God. Shout with joy to the Lord, all you lands. Lift up your voice, rejoice, and sing. Sing to the Lord with the harp and the voice of song, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Shout with joy before the King, the Lord. Let the seas roar and all that fills it, the world and those who dwell therein. Let the rivers clap their hands, and let the hills ring joy before the Lord, who comes to judge the earth. The Lord will judge the world with righteousness and the people with equity. The second reading is from 2 Thessalonians, chapter 3, verses 6 through 13. Some members of the Thessalonian community, because of their belief in the nearness of Christ's return, had ceased to work, living off the generosity of other members of the community. The writer of this letter warns them bluntly that if they want to eat, they need to work. Now we command you, beloved, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to keep away from believers who are living in idleness and not according to the tradition that they receive from us. For you yourselves know how you ought to imitate us. We were not idle when we were with you, and we did not eat anyone's bread without paying for it. But with toil and labor, we worked night and day, so that we might not burden any of you. This was not because we do not have the right, but in order to give you an example to imitate. For even when we were with you, we gave you this command: anyone unwilling to work should not eat. For we hear that some of you are living in idleness, mere busybodies, not doing any work. Now such persons we command and exhort in the Lord Jesus Christ to do their work quietly and to earn their own living. Brothers and sisters, do not be weary in doing what is right. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah, Lord, to whom shall we go? The words of eternal life. Alleluia, alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 21st chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, Jesus said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." They asked him, "Teacher, when will this be? And what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray. For many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and the time is near. Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified. For these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance, for I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Our guests may be seated. I invite the children forward for the children's message. Come on down, guys. ma'am. I know there's too many of y'all this morning for the purpose. It's great. I love it. Y'all want to come over here and sit on the floor so I can see y'all? I like to see your beautiful faces. That gives you a chance to look at my old ugly face. How are y'all doing? Doing good? Yeah? Ooh, better turn that off. You're going to get in trouble. Gotta watch you like a hawk. So, what do y'all want to talk about this morning? Any ideas? What should we talk about this morning? What do we usually talk about? Okay, who do we usually talk about?
Jesus.
Jesus. There you go. Somebody back there is paying attention. Y'all know who Jesus is, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Who is Jesus? Yes, ma'am. The Son of God. Yes. What else, Miss?
Most of our life.
Ooh, that's deep. Sir? William? Your sister was holding your arm up, wasn't she? Yes. You can't trust her, can you? Yes, Jesus is most of our life, without question. Matter of fact, he's pretty much all of our life when it comes right down to the end, you know? And Jesus is talking about the end in our gospel lesson this morning. He's telling us what's going to happen and what to watch out for. And do you know what the most important thing for us to watch out for is? People who say they know when Jesus is coming back. You know, a lot of people have decided they know when Jesus is coming back, and they lead people astray. And whenever they say Jesus is coming back, he didn't come back. Hadn't come back yet, has he? No, not yet. When he does come back, it's going to be a surprise to us. And that's what we're waiting on, is that surprise. But in the meantime, we hold on to him. We don't let anybody else tell us anything other than Jesus, because he is the way. He is all of our life. Right, Miss Ella? Yeah? All of our life. So, keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. Love him, because he loves us. And when he does come back, we'll be ready. And that's all he asks of us. Right? All right, guys. Y'all have a great week. And I will see you all again. All right, let me turn this off. We forgot to turn it off. I usually love to preach on these gospel lessons where Jesus talks about the end of the days, because it's kind of one of those things that you can just really do a good tongue-in-cheek with. Because what Jesus describes has been going on since he was alive and is going to continue to go on, you know. But whenever I was reading the lessons this past week, this first one is, I always read the Old Testament lesson first, the Hebrew Scriptures first, and Malachi just spoke to me. It just spoke to me. Because what he says is, in some sense, while the first part of it is negative and it's judgment and it's death and destruction, it kind of made me feel good. I don't know why, except that I'm a human being, you know, and I want justice in this world. I want the evil to go away. I want the evil to be destroyed, and that's what Malachi is talking about, God's messenger, Malachi. We are living in times that I have never experienced in my life. And everybody I talk to says this world is not any better, is worse than it used to be. In many ways. It's just, I can't remember these sorts of things whenever I was younger, you know, the sort of things that are going on. I mean, politics have always been negative and always been nasty. There's always been mudslinging in politics, you know. And I don't know about y'all, but I was just hoping to God that we would be done with these political ads this past Tuesday. Lord Jesus, we have to endure another 4 weeks.
going to have to keep your remote firmly in your hand while you're watching TV so you can mute as soon as it goes to ads, because you know you're going to be inundated for another 4 weeks. God help us. God help us. Don't forget to vote again, though. Just vote. I don't care what they have to say on TV. Just vote. So we've been putting up with that for the past, how long? Year? Forever. I think that's better. Yeah, forever. That's what it feels like. That's what it feels like. You know, Putin has threatened nuclear attacks in Ukraine with tactical nuclear weapons, which makes no sense whatsoever. If you know anything about tactical nuclear weapons, they really aren't effective except for wiping out small cities. Why would you want to do that except that's what he likes to do, apparently, is hurt people, because he's increased his missile attacks and drone attacks on cities and killing civilians. What a coward. What a coward. Hurricane Ian devastated Florida. Now, folks, there's one thing you have to know about living on the peninsula of Florida. If you live there, you're gonna get wiped out somewhere along the way, right? This ain't rocket science. And then Nicole comes along and undermines foundations on the Atlantic side and starts washing houses into the sea. Once again, I'm sorry. I am sympathetic to these folks, but this ain't rocket science. Don't build your house right next to the ocean, you know? Forest fires continue in the West. Severe drought in the West. It's the worst we've ever seen. The lakes are drying up, and there are some communities that only have promised another 3 months worth of water. It's getting bad. Icebergs are melting. The seas are rising. Have y'all seen the report with the Prime Minister of Tuvalu, small island in the South Pacific, standing in knee-deep water, asking for the major countries to do something about climate change, because what he was standing on used to be dry land? If it keeps on, his little island nation's going to disappear. Tell me the climate change. COVID's still a factor. RSV, y'all hearing that, right? RSV, the kids, they don't have enough room in the children's wards for the RSV children. Flu season has also started. And it's going to be a real winner, apparently. Personal tragedies that shake our faith, we all have them. We all have them. Now, folks, I've just listed a whole bunch of stuff. But I want y'all to tell me, talk to me this morning. I know Lutherans aren't supposed to, but it's okay this morning. I want y'all to talk to me and tell me, what do y'all see? What else besides that do y'all see?
The hand of God at work.
The hand of God at work. Is this a wrathful hand or a loving hand? Always taking care of us, yes, indeed. But that's hold on to that, because I need that for a segue. What else do y'all see? I mean, y'all are paying attention, too. Yes, Kat?
Kids and college students are going to save us from ourselves.
Once again, a good segue. Kids and college students today are going to save us from ourselves. I hope they do. I do hope they do. Division in the country, polarization. What else? New. More and more people being killed every day. Yep. Yep. It's always something, folks. It is always something. But that's where Malachi 4 comes in. That's why it resonated with me this past week as I was looking at this, along with all the things I just listed, and I tried to be tongue-in-cheek with some of them, because if you just keep going, it just really tears you down. But Malachi, God's messenger, says this: "See, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all the arrogant and evildoers will be stubble. The day that comes shall burn them up, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch." Now, folks, this is what's known as the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord is how it's described and what it's called in the Hebrew Scriptures. And it's talked about over and over and over again. But let me give you two examples from two of the other minor prophets. Zephaniah chapter 1, He says, the great day of the Lord is near, near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. The warrior cries aloud there. That day will be a day of wrath, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness. Then Amos in chapter 5, he says, alas for you who desire the day of the Lord. That's absolutely positively correct. Why do you want the day of the Lord? It is darkness, not light, as if someone fled from a lion and was met by a bear, or went into the house and rested a hand against the wall and was bitten by a snake. Is it not the day of the Lord darkness, not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? The day of the Lord, folks, is not a day we want to be asking for. You know, we often talk about we like Jesus to come back tomorrow or today, because when Jesus comes back, that's the day of the Lord. There is to be a reckoning on that day. And that's why this kind of resonated with me. I'm just waiting for that reckoning, and I hope to Lord I'm not caught up in it. You know? Whenever I was in Georgia Tech, the summer of my sophomore year, I worked for Georgia Power downtown. That was back when there was two lanes going in and two lanes coming out, you know? It was a long commute from North Druid Hills Road. Horse and buggy, yeah. That would have been faster. And every day at lunchtime, you know, when we would go out for lunch to the Mad Italian, y'all remember the Mad Italian? One of my favorite restaurants. There would be the street preacher there with this sign that says, repent and be saved. And he was just roaring, beating people up about the head and shoulders about the day of the Lord is near, you know. Repent and be saved, repent and be saved. And all he did was turn people off, because he kept saying, the day of the Lord is near. Well, you know what? Jesus is pretty clear about that. If anybody says they know when Jesus is coming back, and they say, I am he, or I know when he's coming, for Lord's sake, run away from him. And there have been so many people over the centuries that have decided they know when Jesus is coming back, and they have led people astray. They had people sell everything they have and go with them up on a mountaintop and end up destitute because Jesus didn't come back. Every time somebody predicts when Jesus is coming back, I am absolutely, without any question, sure that God says, well, there's another day I can't use. But the good news is what Charlie and Kat said. God is here in the midst of all this business. And the second verse of Malachi says this. He says, but. There ought to be at least three exclamation points after that but. But for you who revere my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. And now we re-spell that word son, S-O-N, because we know who the Son of Righteousness is. He is our hope. But there's also hope in the Hebrew Scriptures as well, in the Minor Prophets. In Hosea chapter 11, listen to this. When Israel was a child, I loved him. And out of Egypt, I called my son. The more I called them, the more they went from me. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and offering incense to idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them up in my arms, but they did not know that I healed them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with bands of love. I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down to them, and I fed them. What Charlie said is correct. That's what this scripture from Hosea says. We don't recognize the hand of God in the midst of this business we call life that can sometimes be so overwhelming that we don't know what to do. And sometimes I think, folks, that's where we find ourselves so often. There's so much negative coming out of the TV and out of media. There's so much negative going on in the world that we're told about and we hear about and we see about, and it's overwhelming. We wonder, where is God in this business? He's right there in Hosea. He said, they did not know that I healed them. We don't even recognize sometimes that God is there in the midst of our lives, in the midst of this negative business we call life. When we're surrounded by evil, when we're surrounded by people and things that just want to take our life from us, who want to suck the life out of us, God is there in the midst of it, because we have been given Jesus as our guide and as our roommate and as our travel mate in this world. Jesus is proof that God is here in the midst of it with us. Without Jesus here in the midst of it, folks, I would fold up my tent and I would go home. And I would just find myself a hole to crawl into, because I don't want to be a part most of the time of the stuff that's going on out there in the world. It's hard sometimes. Jesus lists all those things that are going to be happening, and they've been happening, they continue to happen, they're never going to stop, because they're all created and caused by humans. You know, we're our own worst enemy, are we not? We do it to ourselves. We don't need God to consign us to hell. We do it to ourselves. But Jesus is very clear. I am with you in the midst of all this business, and by your endurance, you will gain your life. You will gain your life. What he means there is that by our endurance, we will be with him forever. Because, folks, he'll let us walk away. He'll let us wander off as that prodigal son did in Luke. And I love that parable. It's my favorite parable, because so many of us, along with myself, have wandered off over our lives, and God is always there waiting for us with open arms saying, come home. There's that wonderful old gospel hymn, come home. You who are waiting, come home. We just need to come home. We endure. So how do we endure in this business? Well, number one, we're here on Sunday mornings. And I can't tell you how important being here is on Sunday mornings. Because it is here that we hear that God loves us in word, and we experience it in sacrament, and we are built up by one another. We're supported by one another, the gift of the communion of saints. We're readied for our journey through the rest of the next week. Because, folks, we got to go back out there in the world and endure all that stuff again. We need to see one another. We need to hear one another. We need to hear one another say, I care about you and love you, and I'll pick you up whenever you fall down, and I'll dust you off whenever you mess up, and I'll remind you that God loves you and forgives you. We need to be here on Sunday mornings. And if you know somebody, folks, that's not here this morning, or somebody who hasn't been here for a while, go find them. Go find them. And remind them that God loves them and that God forgives them. We need to be encouraged by one another, because, folks, without encouragement, it's hard to endure. But we endure simply because we know that God has endured with us throughout history, that he endures with us in the person of his Son that he's given to us. Listen again to Hosea. I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down to them and I fed them. Folks, that's pure grace. Even in the Hebrew scriptures, that's pure grace. God is going to bend down to us again today in this Eucharist. And God's going to feed us once again with his Son, so that his presence is renewed within us, so that our sins are forgiven all anew, so that our spirits are revived and we're made strong for the next week. Because Bev's going to send you out of here and say, go and serve the Lord. Whew. Folks, that's the hardest thing you're going to do this week. You think your jobs are hard? Think about that. That's the hardest thing you're going to have to do this week. So come and be fed.
Please rise as we sing together, Blessed Assurance. Jesus is mine.
Amen. Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory he
is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture, numbers to my side, angels descending, bringing them above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior are happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
God has made us His people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, He rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. United with your saints across time and place, we pray for our shared world. Reviving God, keep your church active in its mission and ministry. Encourage bishops, deacons, pastors, and lay leaders to risk boldly in their proclamation and fill them with wisdom and endurance for challenging times. Lord, in your mercy. Renewing God, as the Northern Hemisphere prepares for winter, make us mindful of the ordered beauty of your creation. Teach us to treasure cycles of rest and new life. Help us care for what you have made. Lord, in your mercy.
Receive our prayer.
Loving God, accompany all who make sacrifices for the sake of others. Safeguard first responders and active duty military personnel. Grant peace to veterans and heal any wounds in body, mind, or spirit. Lord, in your mercy. Healing God, your people cry out to you. Sustain doctors, nurses, and hospital personnel in their tireless work. Uphold mental health professionals and those in their care. May the Sun of Righteousness rise on all who are sick. Lord, in your mercy. Uniting God, unite this assembly in its shared mission and ministry for the sake of the gospel. Highlight ways we can better work together and give us patience to work through disagreement. Lord, in your mercy. God, our shepherd, you bid us welcome the alien among us, and so we pray for the Q family who we are helping to resettle in Clarkston. Bless and keep them as they learn to live in the American culture, and grant that they may thrive and be prosperous in their lives. Lord, in your mercy. God, our mercy, you hear the cries of the people of Ukraine. Bless them with your healing presence and help us to do whatever we can to assist them in these, their dark hours. Inspire our leaders to bring an end to this war. Lord, in your mercy. God, our healer, hear your people as we lift those in need up to you by name, out loud, or in our hearts. We pray for all who are on our prayer list. Visit them with your healing spirit. We pray for the faculty, staff, and students of Kennesaw State University as they continue their mission of education, and we pray for our sister congregation, Mount Zion AME Church. Bless and preserve them. Lord, in your mercy. God, our courage, we pray for our presiding Bishop Elizabeth and our Bishop Kevin. Bless them with your wisdom as they lead our church in these uncertain times. Lord, in your mercy. God of justice, the racial profiling of people of color and innocent victims of racist attacks continues to plague this nation. We are committed to condemning all forms of bigotry. Inspire us to make our actions as strong as our words. Lead us to advocate and be a voice for those whose voices have been taken from them. Help us to bring comfort, peace, and hope as we continue to struggle for justice for all of your children. Lord, in your mercy. Consoling God, abide with all who grieve for loved ones who have died. Comfort us with the promise of resurrection and new life with you. Lord, in your mercy.
Accept these prayers, gracious God, and those known only to you, Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
Let's share that peace among ourselves.
love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onwards to the prize before us, soon his beauty we'll behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Blessed are you, maker of all things. As you have entrusted us with all that you have created, now gather our gifts, nourish us with this sacrament, and send us to those who hunger and thirst for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power, God of might, heaven and earth are full of your glorious power in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, you have brought us this far along the way. In times of bitterness, you did not abandon us, but guided us into the path of love and light. In every age, you sent prophets to make known your loving will for all humanity. The cry of the poor has become your own cry. Our hunger and thirst for justice is your own desire. In the fullness of time, you sent your chosen servant to preach good news to the afflicted, to break bread with the outcast and despised, and to ransom those in bondage to prejudice and sin. It was he who, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is being given up for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is being shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we await the day when Jesus shall return to free all the earth from the bonds of slavery and death. Come, Lord Jesus, and let the church say amen.
Amen.
Send your Holy Spirit, our advocate, to fill the hearts of all who share this bread and cup with courage and wisdom, to pursue love and justice in all the world. Come, Spirit of freedom, and let the church say amen.
Amen.
Join our prayers and praise with your prophets and martyrs of every age, that rejoicing in the hope of the resurrection, we might live in the freedom and hope of your Son. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now we're bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God who bears away the sin of the world. Thanks be to God.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us risen will bring in the kingdom.
Jesus risen will bring in the kingdom.
Rising sun, oh, Lord, have mercy.
body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ keep you and strengthen you in his grace to eternal life.
Amen. We give you thanks, most gracious God, that you have fed us with the bread of heaven and given us a foretaste of paradise. Enliven us to be your body in the world and to serve those who are in need through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord look upon his face, your face will shine upon you. The Lord make you, let me just start over, may I? That song was one of my favorites and it's got me going here. Do-over, thank you. It's a mulligan in golf. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Martha Willis suggested this song way back at the beginning of the year to support the people of Ukraine, and I and we decided to continue doing it until this horrible war is over. So we dedicate this to the people of Ukraine once again.
Also, one more thing I forgot this morning. Our Wednesday night prayer meeting with Mount Zion is this coming Wednesday at 6 o'clock here at First United. So come out and pray with us. We have a good time. We sing, we pray, we support one another. It's a good evening. So 6 o'clock here at First United. And thank you to Nathan for playing with us this morning.
And we dedicate this to the people of Ukraine.
This is my song, O God of all the nations, a song of peace for lands of far and wide. This is my home, the country where my heart is. Here are my hopes, my dreams, my
to love and serve the Lord as Christ's worker in the vineyard.
Thanks be to God.
It's great to see you.
She's working.
It's really a pretty place. I was surprised. We went there and climbed up in these cathedrals, these big rock cathedrals. It was really pretty Catholic. Yeah. Church of the Cross, built by a student of Frank Lloyd Wright. And is that a video? No, I must have taken a picture of my display. I don't know why I did that. But, yeah, tons and tons of this type of stuff.